Welcome, I'm Chris Davis, and I'm a researcher in the field of energy and industry studies. In this talk, I'll give you an overview of what network theory is, how we use it to describe systems, and the implications it has for helping us to understand real-world systems. You often hear the words network and graph used interchangeably, so people may sometimes refer to network theory or to graph theory when describing the same thing. Network theory is a study of graphs, which are mathematical structures that are used to model pairwise relations between objects from a certain collection. In very simple terms, everything is a node or an edge. Nodes and edges can be used to represent many different things, although generally nodes are used to represent entities such as people, organizations, or even molecules, while edges typically represent relationships between these entities. These relationships could indicate friendships, monetary payments, emails, interactions, citations between academic articles, and so forth. These two simple concepts of nodes and edges give us a powerful framework that allows us to do very sophisticated types of analysis. There are many different types of graphs that we can define given the nature of their edges and what they are describing. An undirected graph is composed of edges that simply connect nodes. In other words, they're just a connection, and that's all we know. We can also have what are called directed graphs, where the edges have some sort of direction specified. This could indicate that something flows from one node to another, or it can flow in both directions between the nodes. An example of this would be a graph indicating monetary flows, where money would be paid by one node to another node. A weighted graph indicates that the edges have some number associated with them. This could indicate the value of the monetary transaction between the two nodes. You can also have what is called a property graph, where edges have a label or a particular meaning. You can think of Facebook as being a giant property graph, where you are a node and you have edges connecting you to things that you like, and there are also edges connecting you to your friends. With this basic structure, they are able to perform sophisticated types of analysis to examine the graph and recommend things to you based on what types of things your friends like, and also characterize people's known and likely preferences. You can think of graphs as having different types of shapes, which are based on the patterns in which their nodes are interconnected. This is what we mean when we talk about the topology of a graph. Here you can see a couple of examples that are common in the real world. The type of network that people choose to create really depends on the type of application. For some networks, the objective may be to connect the nodes with the fewest number of edges, or to make sure that there are connections between nodes even if a single edge is removed, such as when a power line is broken in a storm. We know that networks can have different topologies, and it is important to also look at a few ways of measuring networks which can help us to better characterize them. One such metric is called the network diameter, and can be understood as being the longest, shortest path. In the matrix, you can see the shortest distances in terms of the number of edges traversed when traveling from any node to any other node. In this case, the network diameter is 4, since the path from node 2 to node 7 involves the most number of edges traversed. You can also take the same data about the shortest paths and then take the average of these. You can consider this as a measure of the efficiency of the network, since it indicates on average how long would it take to go from any node to any other node. Now, there are different ways in which the same set of nodes can be connected together, and how we decide to connect them really depends on what we care about in the network. For example, with a power grid, we want a network that is a compromise between economic costs and also with redundancy. We want to make sure that there can be at least two paths by which power can get to our homes in case a storm hits and breaks a power line in one of those paths. At the same time, we don't want to have too many edges between nodes, as that can get prohibitively expensive. How we add edges can affect network metrics, or measures that we have to quantify various properties of these networks. In A through D, we can see four different types of networks that consist of the nodes in the same exact positions. What you see in the plot is that we're trying to get an idea of the relationship between the average path length versus the network length. The average shortest path length is the average of the shortest path between all the permutations of the different nodes. In other words, it measures how many edges you would have to traverse to reach any node from any other node. The network length is the number of all the edges in the network, or the sum of the weights if you have a weighted graph. This type of plot is important if you're planning some sort of infrastructure. If you have a network like you see in A, you don't want to have many edges, which means that you will not need that many connections, such as pipelines, power lines, etc., to connect together all the different nodes. The downside of this is that traveling through the nodes generally takes a long time. With graph D, we have the opposite situation, where all the nodes can be quickly reached from all the other nodes, but the network is very expensive in terms of the number of edges that need to be built. Graphs B and C represent a kind of compromise where you try to get the best of both worlds. Still, these are very different types of networks, and you can see that with C, if you take out the central node, then all the nodes become unconnected, while with B, the network would largely stay intact if the same node is removed. It is interesting to note that you have diminishing marginal returns past a certain point. As you add more edges, these get smaller and smaller reduction in terms of the reduction in the average shortest path length. Basically, at some point, it's not really economical to keep on adding more edges beyond that point. With the growth of networks, we can often see a type of path dependency based on how they are formed. In the case of the electricity grid, this started with individual cities having their own power plant. The grid first expanded to connect cities to suburbs and then cities to other cities. Eventually, this spread so that provinces were linked up, and now in Europe, we are increasing the interconnections between countries. For the power grid, this is very much a bottom-up process. The gas grid has evolved much differently instead. Instead of consisting of distributed production centers, like with a power grid, the pipelines have mostly been built to take gas from the Latroningen field in the northeast of the Netherlands, and then transport this to the rest of the country, along with the cross into Germany, into Belgium, into the UK. Even though these networks are serving many of the same areas, their topologies are actually quite different. Now consider two different types of graphs. First, here we have what is called a random graph, where you have a set of nodes and then start adding edges randomly between any two nodes until all the nodes in this set are connected. In other words, there is an equal probability that any two nodes will be connected. Now with a preferentially attached graph, we have a different situation, where certain nodes are more popular than others and nodes are more likely to be attached to them. A few nodes may have many edges, while most nodes only have a few edges. The topology of these two graphs can have a large influence on how they respond to failures into attacks. Here we define robustness of the graph in terms of the number of nodes that are still connected into a single connected graph. If you have a graph where most nodes are preferentially attached to a handful of nodes, if there are random failures or random nodes removed, the graph will largely remain intact. However, if you have a targeted attack and remove the node with the highest degree or the most links to the other nodes, the graph will likely split apart. However, with a randomly grown graph, a targeted attack would be not as effective, since most of the nodes have more or less the same number of connections. In other words, no one node really acts as a central hub for the network, and as such is more robust. One of the amazing things that we see in society is that with the networks that we inhabit, these structures self-assemble, even though no one's in control. Do you ever go to the grocery store and say, wow, they have milk, how'd they guess that I wanted that? The thing is, whenever you buy milk, you set off a chain of events. Your purchase is a vote that propagates throughout the system. You don't have to tell the delivery man how to package the bottles or how much to send. You don't have to tell the farmer when to milk the cows or how to feed them. In reality, these systems look a bit like what you're seeing here. What you're looking at is a network that shows the monetary flows between different industrial sectors within a single country. Each node represents an industry, such as car manufacturers and makers of wool textiles. Each edge indicates the payments that are made as companies in that sector have to buy materials from other industrial sectors in order to produce their products. So the car industry has to buy from the glass industry, the rubber industry, and the steel industry. The clusters with a large number of connections indicate industries that are quite similar to each other. This particular network visualization is from a paper called The Product-Space Conditions of the Development of Nations, and therein they argue that the nature of the connections within this network influences the economic development pathway of that nation. The idea they state is that economies grow by upgrading the products that they produce and export. This comes down to the idea of complementary capital. For example, if you have a large computer chip manufacturing industry, it's not too difficult to shift to producing photovoltaics. Both of these industries have overlap in terms of the types of skills and machinery that is needed. In this paper, they argue that developing countries run into problems since the industries they have are not always complementary, particularly in the directions in which they would like to grow. In other words, in order to grow a particular type of industry, you need to have a pathway of sufficiently similar industries that allow you to shift the existing capital into that new direction. In other words, the current state of the network and the nature of existing industries reinforces the current situation. So thank you for your attention, and I hope that you've enjoyed the lecture.